One of the things that is so interesting about this festival and an unusual opportunity is that it brings together entrepreneurs, artists, scientists, you know, visionaries. And there's been a lot of talk about how people achieve their vision, whether it's cultural, social, or political. And so I would just like to start with you to tell us how you started, how you got started, and how you managed to build this incredible business.
Yeah, so I started, actually, the first business I started pretty young when I was, I think, 12, 13 years old. I started to sell music. After that, 1990, I started to sell computer games. I started to erase my father's music, like ABBA and Bonnie M and so on, and remember those games on tapes, on Spectrum computers that you are linking to the cassette tape. And after that, selling games, I realized that I'm very good at talking with people. And I developed my selling skills. In the same time, I was a programmer and I was starting to learn about IT in a structured way. And I was thinking in very logical, so I developed my logical thinking with a full understanding of all the consequences. And that leads, when I was 22, I dropped the university and I started my first business, let's say official business, with selling computers in the center of Bucharest, small apartment. And from the beginning, I started to dream pretty big. And
did you have, you know, you went back to when you were 12 and 13, but was it this process step by step of discovering and thinking, okay, now I have a different idea, or were you thinking big from the very beginning? Did you have this vision always of where you wanted to go?
At the beginning, to be honest, I had a pretty limited, vision and mission. So when we were young, we were lacking a lot of things. And for me, I remain with this trauma of lacking chocolate. I had only one chocolate per year, and I remember I kept the, how it's called, the package from the chocolate inside my books because of the smell, and I kept it for many, many months. So at the beginning, I just wanted to make some money to buy a chocolate. After that, I wanted to make some money to buy, and yeah, from a lot of chocolate, I was more than 100 kilos when I was around 24, 25, and after that I started to lose weight. The second big, objective was to buy an apartment or to have something my own. And after that I realized that I can dream even higher. And when I had the opportunity, 2008, 2009, and I saw eMAG business, which back then was pretty small e-commerce business doing less than 2 million euros in monthly sales, I said that I could transform the business into something a regional leader, and I managed to acquire the business 2009, beginning of 2009. And my vision from back then was to build the biggest e-commerce business in the region and to reach 1 billion.
It's very ambitious to be thinking so big at a time of a global recession.
Yeah. It was, and people said I was crazy, totally crazy. One, because I left my old company, which back then was doing like 100 million in revenue, and more than a million in yearly profit and solid business, for a company that was doing a lot of losses and together with all the uncertainty, But I was pretty ambitious, and I saw from the beginning that this is great potential for me and also for business. And I had another question back then. I had a question, what I realized till 2009 was something related to luck, or I have something that still is not discovered. And I wanted to understand why and what am I good for. I wanted to start again from zero, from the beginning. And it was also a personal challenge for me to take this company and reorganize and start it to grow.
From your platform as an entrepreneur, I think it would be very interesting, particularly at this conference and given all the other speakers, though, to hear your view on some of the social and political issues that are coming in the development of businesses. And one is how everyone here, on the one hand, is a consumer, and we want the lowest price possible to buy something. And everyone here will be a worker, and you want the highest salary possible. And these two things are really grinding against each other, particularly in the world of e-commerce. And I'm wondering how you see that playing out, because every country, it seems, is beginning to deal with this tension that is increasing social inequality.
Yeah, this is very, very interesting. And actually, this is my role in the company. As a CEO, I think I have two roles. One, I'm the keeper of vision and culture of the company. And the second one is the, let's say, moderator between the interests of all the stakeholders. And we put in our company the customer first, and after that we have the employees, we have the business partners, which are the sellers or supplier for goods, supplier for services. We have the state, because we are an important, let's say, employer in the market and taxpayer in the market. And also we have the shareholders. Mm-hmm. Everyone wants something, and everyone wants more. And it is my role how to make the how to distribute the value which we are creating. Mm-hmm. For example, for the customers, we took money from investors. And during the last 5 years, we took a lot of money for Romania, more than $200 million. We worked hard, we took the right decisions, we employed, intelligent people. But what was important was the capital, which gave us the possibility to invest. Mm-hmm. By investing capital in technology, we gain efficiency. When we gain efficiency, and I will give you a very simple example. In the warehouse, one picker in the warehouse who's picking products from the shelf, 2 years ago was doing around 50 pickings per hour. We visited some warehouses in Western Europe, in US, also in China, and we saw the productivity up to 300 pickings per hour. And we started to ask ourselves why. And we saw a lot of technology, a lot of things in terms of managing people. And we started to improve this productivity using the investment that we took. And we managed to achieve 100. Now we are around 120 and growing. And the objective for the year end is to reach 180. That means the cost per picking an item, that makes the cost per operating every product, is going down. And this is creating some value. And this value is divided between the customer, because we are able to offer better prices, we are able to offer better services, and in the same time we are able to increase the salaries, both in the warehouse, but also for the, let's say, white collars, we're not calling this way, but It's a familiar term for the people who are designing things and building technology.
Now, that's a cycle, is a kind of win-win cycle, as you described it. Now, I can tell you that the answer, if you were an American CEO sitting here, the order in which you mentioned those things would have been very different. So the first would be, our first responsibility is to the shareholder, okay? Yeah. And in fact, I think you started to do an MBA, you know, in the US. Harvard Business School came out a number of years ago with the theory, essentially, that the shareholder is the only stakeholder that matters. And we have seen that increasingly be the case, certainly in the United States. And so what's happening is that workers are not sharing. Yes, prices go down a little bit, but the more productivity you're talking about is created wealth, is creating wealth, but that is not being equally distributed, or at least even proportionally distributed.
I'm seeing this more and more in US, yes, but our culture is different. I think European culture is different, Romanian culture is different, and our company's culture is different. And back in 2011, 2012, when I attracted my co-investor, Naspers, they came with the money, I fought pretty hard, and I was not so aware at that time for the right of control. Even if I have only 20% of the company as a shareholder, I have equal rights of control with them. And I know this is happening also for Amazon, for example. Even if Jeff Bezos has only, I think, 17% of Amazon, he has more than 50% of the rights, voting rights of the company. The same for Facebook, the same for Jack Ma and Alibaba. So they have the power to change things and to decide on important things. And usually the investors, they are asking for return. This is the main metric that they are looking for. It's IRR, it's the return on the capital they invested. Once you keep this IRR to a normal level, let's say plus 20%, plus 25%, if you want to give a good IRR, they will be happy. And you need all the time to explain long-term, the implication on sacrificing the long-term, that means usually the customer and employees, for the short-term returns. And this is why it is my task, and it is my, let's say, my fight between the stakeholders that I need to manage, which is sometimes between short-term and long-term. Because they are asking, they want returns now, usually, the shareholders, and they want fast returns. I want stable business, so I want to invest in developing new things that not all the time the money invested are coming with revenue immediately. Sometimes the money invested are coming with customer engagement. And after customer engagement, you find the monetization, and after 2-3 years, you start to make some money. So this is something that you need to explain, and you need to properly argue to the investors.
But that argument is not winning the day in most companies. Some, yes. And is the system grinding away at that? Because, yes, you have managed in your company to maintain this kind of control. But if you know, you got outmaneuvered, somebody else could come in and say, we're not going to take that long-term strategy.
Yeah, I think I have also the advantage of being shareholder and manager in the same time. As manager, I want adrenaline, so I want to have some action. So I want to have new things to develop. I want to drive this Formula One car every day because it's bringing me a lot of energy back. And this luxury of having the two hats, the shareholder and the manager hat, keeps me in this loop of understanding what the shareholder wants, what the manager wants. Usually the companies that are run by professional managers which are not founders, they started to lose this focus on the long-term things. Yeah. So this is the danger that Harvard was talking about, mm-hmm. and it's happening in US. And my fight will be to keep this long-term vision explained to all the stakeholders, because this is what will keep the value for the company intact. Because if we'll start to monetize everything that we have today, we'll make some money, but we'll lose the future value of the company, which makes at the end the value of the share or the value of the entire company.
I'm interested in, given how young, in a way, Romania's capitalist economy is, what you think are some of, or if there still are, cultural drags that make it difficult? And in what way maybe are those good, or in what way there may be hindrances?
Yeah, I think we are young in this world. And I think we jumped to the capitalist economy like 25, 30 years ago without understanding anything. Neither from the macroeconomic perspective, neither from the business side. And from the, intelligence perspective, creativity perspective, working hard perspective, Romanian entrepreneurs are the same as Western Europeans or American entrepreneurs. So we are the same. But I think there are two points that are missing. One is the knowledge about how the economy is working, how the system is working. They are not teaching us at school. Even today, when we are 25 years away in this, capitalist system, the focus, number one focus is on work, not on capital, not on understanding capital. Work is important, but first is capital. To understand how the system works, to prioritize work based on the capital return, down to the personal level. So this is number one. And the second one is lack of capital. We don't have capital in our economy. With the risk, and I'm not talking here about capital from the banks, because the banks have tons of money, but the companies, they don't have risk capital. This is
what they would call venture capital in the
exactly,
US.
Exactly. But those things are going together, because the entrepreneurs not having the financial education right, they are not building 5 years or 10-year plans, and they are not selling their idea or their business to the investors for capital, for risk capital. I was lucky in 2012 when the investment fund came. Actually, I was looking for an investment fund for already 3 years, and I was lucky to have already some experience, some 10-year experience with my previous distribution company. And I learned along the way by doing things, not by going to school. By doing things, I learned a lot of things about financial and about returns and so on. And I was able to build a 10-year plan and present it to the investors with the, assumptions pretty well argued. And they bought this 10-year plan, and they started to come with money. They came with 1 million, after that with 5 million, after that with 10 million. And we took 200 million and we invested into technology and expanded in other market, and more important, into growing the culture of the company and growing people inside the company. So lack of education and lack of capital, this is what differentiates, I think, Romania, entrepreneur.
And in terms of the educational system, overall, nationally, do you think that's in a very bad state now? It's had lack of investment for years now.
I think you can say an educational system is bad or good. You need to look at what is the objective. the country objective. And I think this is something that we are missing in Romania. We don't have a vision shared by all the institutions in the country. A vision shared by the parliament, which names the government, by the presidency, by the National Bank, and so on. So all the core institutions in the company, they don't share the same vision about the country. And by not sharing the same vision, they are not sharing a common objective or a common plan for the country. So we lack the plan of the country. And the educational system is something that it's executing on this plan. So you need people with a specific mindset 20 years from now. This is how you adjust the educational system. This is one point regarding how the education system should work. And second one is how the education today is executing. Yes, I think it is in a bad, so the execution is bad because the salaries for teachers are low. And from what I know, Romania took a waiver 10 years ago when Romania joined EU not to increase the salaries for doctors and for teachers. And that was a dramatic hit for both systems, and we can see today. There is a huge pool of talent for IT people in Romania. But they need to be proper trained. And in order to be proper trained, they need proper teachers. And there are some teachers which are, let's say, vocational teachers. So they want to be in the system and they stay there no matter what. But looking at young teachers that are entering into the system, the share of vocational teachers is less and less. So I think they are less than 20%. The rest of the teachers, imagine that they are paid with 500 euros, while we are paying, let's say, a good programmer with 2,000, 3,000 euro monthly. Yeah.
So why does anybody want to be a teacher instead of a programmer?
Yeah, so this is a problem. And
but I want to go back to one thing you talked about, which was the vision and these competing visions. What are? Can you be more specific about what the competing visions are?
Yeah, I think they're not competing all the time. I think some of them, they are lacking completely the vision. What Romania should be in 20 years from now? What is the objective? How, actually, I think the all the institutions, they should look at prosperity and define prosperity with metrics. Because if you say something is good or is bad, you need to put some numbers and you need to measure. Otherwise, there will be debate going back and forth, and I say it's right, you say it's bad. And I think prosperity is maybe GDP per capita. This is one. And I think the second one is inequality in the system, measured by Gini index. So the top 10% compared to the bottom 10% of the population, the income. Right. So I think those two, and they need to set those two objectives, and they need to start working. And how you can obtain them? From my perspective, and meeting with all the other entrepreneurs and business associations, I think I see four areas of improvement. I think one, and which is medium long term, is education and changing the system and teaching the young kids things for tomorrow. We are still teaching kids about being a good specialist, but the tomorrow jobs, we don't know how they will be. Even today, jobs are totally different than 10 or 20 years ago. So I think they need to rely less on understanding and doing specific tasks and more on adaptability skills. Our system lacks and actually is not simulating innovation because people are teach to follow. They are teach to behave. They are not teach to express themselves, and their authenticity is cut from early ages. And this is the difference between, let's say, Romanian system and British or American system. So we need to stimulate authenticity, we need to stimulate innovation, we need to teach young kids about finance and about money, because this is the system we are working on, it's based on money. So this is a big change. So this is one, education. The second one, I think we need infrastructure. And infrastructure is road infrastructure, rail infrastructure, but also gas infrastructure. If you look at the countryside, where more than 40% of Romania population lives, they lack roads. So this, because of lack of roads, goods and services are expensive, and they are paying more. Or goods are scarce, and the ones available, they are expensive because of scarcity. After that, there is lack of gas, natural gas. And half of the time, so the people living in countryside, they are spending their time just to survive. So they need to replace the lack of gas with the wood and with the, all the other things. They need to do them manually. And they're not productive. I was debating with my friends. I don't know if you know, there is, how it's called in English, with the pig disease that is happening in Romania. I know, like close to 500,000 pigs died because pig,
like an epidemic.
Epidemic thing. And I think there is a tradition in Romania, there is a, you know, the pig is kind of symbol in the countryside. Every family needs to have a pig. And this is fundamentally wrong from the economic perspective. So the pigs, they need to stay all together in a farm. And they need to be treated well, I don't know, from a vet perspective, but also from economic perspective. And the return per family will be higher, and they don't need to take care every family with their pig, because they're losing a lot of efficiency. Yeah. So there are a lot of things wrong about infrastructure and about setting this infrastructure to the countryside.
Do you see political parties that are organizing or coalescing around some of these ideas, or no?
No, no. Because I think there is lack of financial education, again. So they are debating right and wrong based on perceptions. And financial education is teaching you to go for return, to go for money. Money is not something that is number one objective for us, but is something common for everything we are doing. This is what the capitalism is teaching us. And this is my lesson every time I'm going to US. This is the lesson I'm learning, that everything must be, I don't know, analyzed based on money, based on return. Coming back, I think third point is the digital infrastructure of Romania. And maybe we are talking about digital infrastructure in a countryside having such, big problems. I went to India, and India is leapfrogging a lot of other countries by investing in the right things in digital. And they are building a new way of looking at internet. And the vision of India is data-rich country. And data-rich means data-rich per individual. So you own the data, and by their system is called Aadhaar, which is foundation. They are scanning everybody in the country, so they have a digital ID, fingerprint, retina, and face ID.
Isn't that kind of scary in terms of...
It's not. It's not, because you control the data. You are in control of the data. The state is just somebody that takes care of everything. Imagine that data is something in American internet and also European internet, it's owned by companies.
Right. I don't trust them.
Chinese internet data is owned by the state.
And I don't trust the government either.
But we need to address this issue. In Indian internet, data is, managed, so the framework is managed by the state, but owned by individuals. And you have access, you have your account aggregator, where you have access to all your job data, previous job data, and you can give access to your new employer and say, hey, look, I have my data with my experience and my performance from previous employers. Please take this data, I'm sharing with you, but you must pay me for this data. The same, you have the health data. Look, my health is okay, give me a better insurance or whatever. You have the shopping data, you have the, social behavior data. And this is something you control in India. And this is something that we can look at, because India is now exporting this model of internet. They signed already with the 18 countries. I don't remember them, but I remember Morocco, Singapore. They started to implement this model of internet. So this is something to look at, because we are not rich, but we can be data rich. And there are small steps that can be taken. For example, the interfaces we are interacting with authorities. Those interfaces are now the physical spaces, but we can move them online. And that will make the interaction with the authorities predictable. They will improve their cash flow, because the money will come faster. The citizen will be respected and will feel respected, and will save a lot of time and will save money. So by making those small steps, and what means building interfaces? Making a mobile interface, making forms usable, like in e-commerce, for example, making payments very, very easy, remembering your credentials, maybe linking all the databases from local and different central authorities in order to keep only one ID, and keep this ID in your face ID in your phone, and just log in and pay everything very, very fast. That will make an extremely, extremely convenient experience when everybody will gain. And this is something very easy to do, and easier than building road infrastructure.
Let me just stop you one second there, because I do want to open it up to questions soon. I think there's probably will be a microphone around, but let me ask you one thing. We've been talking about finance and data, and let me bring it back to the community. I noticed walking through Bucharest, and this is my first visit here, lots of empty storefronts. And it reminded me about New York, because in my neighborhood, I see many empty storefronts. And it is a result of the success of e-commerce and people buying things online, which is very troubling to retail. And they just can't compete. And so, putting aside the economics, there's a sense of community, a physical community that comes when you have people on the street and stores. There's a theorist, Jane Jacobs, that talked a lot about neighborhoods and how they thrive. So how do we take care of that piece of it in a world that is increasingly becoming where commerce is being handled online?
If we are talking about street commerce in Romania, I think there are two points. I wished to be a disruption came from e-commerce, but I think the contribution of e-commerce is small.
I think so far.
So far, from the studies, I don't really trust them 100%. 3/4 of adult population of Romania lacks the basic of digital skills, which is something pretty sad. That makes the customer base for us pretty, pretty limited. And we need to go offline to convince people after that to come online. But I think the impact is from shopping centers and shopping malls, who are, let's say, in convenient locations, and everything moves there. And the development of shopping centers, big hypermarkets inside the city, was done in Romania without building impact studies. And by building them in convenient locations inside the cities, they disrupted the small businesses, like restaurants, like, I don't know, commerce and entertainment and everything. And the traffic was built on shopping malls. And there is another point, which is against street locations in Romania, is the weather. We have from cold and extreme cold to extremely hot weather. If you're going to Italy, where the weather is okay for, let's say, 9 months of the year, people are on the street and they are shopping in the street locations, and the street locations are developed. I know the New York weather is maybe similar to Romania, but in Romania you can find 1 kilometer away at least one shopping mall. And the traffic went to those shopping malls, and they were developed pretty easily without impact studies. And although, if you're going to Germany, you can't build something inside the city without an impact study for local entrepreneurs. But local entrepreneurs were called, old way of doing commerce, unfiscalized commerce, or so on. So this is the modern commerce.
That happened in the U.S. too, but now the next step of what's happening is these shopping malls are basically dying, and they're these empty hulks now. Because, so now you've got all of these dead shopping malls that used to be centers, but that e-commerce is basically disrupted. And that's why going back to the street model seems so essential now. I mean, maybe it's everything old is new again, but.
Yeah, I think also if we are comparing shopping malls per capita in Romania and US, US is the most developed. And it was a very tough competition for shopping centers. And there is a lot of retail space per capita. While in Romania, we are more than 10 times lower per retail space per capita. So there is some big difference. So I don't see shopping malls dying. I think they are doing pretty well. And also, I think the rent prices in shopping mall is given by the country risk and the yield that investors are asking. And those yields in Romania are pretty high, more than 10%, which, for example, if you compare to Poland is around 5-6%. This is why the prices per square meter is lower if you are asking about retail space, office space, warehouse space. Prices in Poland are even half of prices in Romania because of the yields and also lack of capital.
Yeah. Now let me, the lights, it makes it a little bit hard for me to see. I think I see a question there, this woman at the end. Here, come up.
Okay. So, hello, my name is Gabriela. And I have a comment and a question.
Okay, very short comments.
Short comment. For more than 10 years, I'm attending conferences, forums, where successful business people in Romania are speaking about their vision, about their dreams, about their success, and about the darkness in Romania. And the darkness is the same, lack of education, lack of infrastructure. What I'm not hearing is about solution and what those successful people are doing to bring the light. As one amazing speaker yesterday said that in order to show the dark in a country or in a community, show the light. So my personal example, I'm sick and tired waiting for successful people with capital, if connections, to do something in Romania. So from March to present, while working in a multinational, having an average salary, I organized more than 40 educational projects with 11 NGOs. I'm planning to start my own NGO, to be a social entrepreneur, and to enter politics while working in a multinational.
And the question?
And the question is, what you are doing personally as a successful people, a person with capital, with connections, with everything that I do not have, bringing right. the light in okay. Romania? Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, very, very good question. Very good question. I had my idea how to improve, let's say, the community around me for many years. And I built, I think 6 years ago, I started the eMAG Foundation, where I started to involve in education. First, we started from the top, and we started to understand that in order to change things in Romania, we need to have good people at the top. And we started to focus on people going to International Olympics. And we valued them, we gave them all the support needed. After that, we started to go down to National Olympics. After that, we formed excellency centers. We have 31 like this, from 6th degree to 12th degree. 5,000 people going there every Saturday with the programma. There is a contest of going there. So 31, math, physics, and IT. After that, we started to go, and we are investing like €500,000 per year in this program. After that, we started to go to countryside for scholar abandonment. How is it called? People dropping school in the countryside.
Dropouts.
Yeah. Yeah, and we started to adopt schools, and the first year we took 6 schools where we paid teachers to have the extra hours with the kids that needs additional education, starting from 2nd degree to 5th degree. After that, it's very difficult to put them back on track. And this year we'll have 25 schools, and my aim is to reach 1,000 in 7 years. And we are building now a marketplace platform for adoption for schools in the countryside, where everybody who wants to contribute to adopting a school, and for that we are building interfaces, and we are building also the system to be a system, not to, let's say, give the full power to the local teacher. We'll put them into a system in order to increase the level of education and in order to keep the people in the school, because usually they are dropping school because they don't understand anymore what is happening in school, and because their parents are not sending them to school, because they are sending them to work for the field or with animals. That was happening 6 years ago. 3 years ago, when we had elections for Bucharest, I started.
Iulian, let me yeah. just interrupt you there, one, because I want to get to other questions. But just to take that question, how can you systematize that instead of one person's individual? What, you know, you're giving the list of eMAG people could say it's enough, it's not enough, but. How do you institutionalize that?
For education, we are now talking with all the other entrepreneurs who are investing in education. So we are talking with Romanian Business Leaders, which is a foundation of entrepreneurs. And we are talking with Florin Talpeș, who developed Merito. We are talking with Superteach. We are talking with Ovidiu Ro. We are talking with AVE, so all the foundation, big foundations with investment in education, we started to do things together. It's pretty difficult to change things because from political, the view is totally, totally different. So we started to change from above. I started, as you said, involving in politics. I think this is something that we need to think about. I had, let's say, my idealist dream that I will support somebody who will change it, who will change politics. And me and another entrepreneur, we stayed behind for local mayorship elections behind Nicu Șordan. And we helped him a lot to do research, to do a lot of things. And he was close to take the mayorship in Bucharest. After that, we saw that some things were lacking. The guy is fantastic, and I still believe we have potential. And today, the way I'm seeing the involvement, I think everybody needs to, like you are saying, we need to think what we are good at and do this thing. If this is something that can change the society, do our job better. If I'm thinking that my business, it's improving and adding value to the society because attracting capital or investing this capital in training people or improving technology that will save people money and time, this is something good. I'm doing this and I'm working for this. And more than that, what we are trying to do, like a few entrepreneurs in Romania, we are building business associations to try to put this agenda and common vision to all the institutions.
I'm sorry we didn't get to answer everyone's questions. We're just running out of time. But Iulian, thank you so much for spending time. Thank you all
thank
for
you.
Your questions.
Thank you, everybody.